Sri Gurupya Namaha. I am Lakshmi from Ponvidyashram. Today I am going to continue the chapter in history, the Mughal Empire. In previous parts of the video, we read about who were Mughals, Mughals' traditions of successions, Mughal relation with other rulers, Mansabdas, Jagidas, Jab, and Zamindas, and also about the six powerful Mughal rulers. Among the six rulers, Akbar was unquestionably the greatest ruler. About his policies, we are going to see in this part of video. Akbarnama and Aini Akbari. Akbar's full name is Jalaluddin Muhammad Akbar. The Mughal Emperor Akbar had more than 4,000 books in his library. He encouraged study of mathematics, logic, astronomy, geometry, and even moral education. He ordered his close friend and courtier Abul Fazl to write a history of his reign. The result was Akbarnama by Abul Fazl, written in Persian. It also gives a biographical account of Akbar. It has been bound in three volumes. The first volume deals with genealogy and gives a biographical account of the Mughal rulers up to that time when Akbar was 17 years old. The second volume gives details of 18 years of Akbar's rule. Aini Akbari forms the third volume of this book, dealing with the matter of administration and revenue of the state. A closer look, Akbar's policies. Abul Fazl, one of the nine gems in Akbar's court and author of Akbarnama, a biographical account of Akbar, refers to Akbar in one of the verses as a shining soul. Abul Fazl had joined the Mughal court in 1574 AD. He believed in the divine powers of Emperor Akbar. The main features of Akbar's administration. Abul Fazl in his Akbarnama says that the empire was divided into provinces called Subas. The Subas was governed by the Subedas. Subedas are those who carried out both political and military functions. For maintenance of the accounts, each province also had a financial officer or Diwan. The Subedas were supported by the following officers. They are the military paymaster called Bakshis, the minister in charge of religious and charitable patronage, they are called Sat, military commanders, they are called Fauzas, and the town police commander are called Kotwal. The Mughal nobility mainly consisted of Turanis from Central Asia, Iranis from Iran, Afghans from Afghanistan, and diverse groups of Indian Muslims. Rajputs were also among the Indian groups of nobility. The nobility also formed a part of Mughal court. It is a remarkable achievement of Akbar to have ensured loyalty of these diverse groups. He ensured that there was no challenge from these groups to his empire. In the 17th century, however, the loyalties of the nobility to the empire weakened. Many of the powerful nobles asserted their own self-interest. Akbar built a new capital city at Fatehpur Sikri near Agra. It was essentially a fortified complex with the royal palace and other buildings. At his court at Fatehpur Sikri, discussions took place about the religious policies in which ulamas, Brahmins, Jews belonging to Roman Catholics and Zoroastrians took part. Some of these religious scholars emphasized rituals and dogmas. They were often referred to as boycotts. Their system of beliefs created divisions and disharmony in society. What do you mean by dogma? A statement given by authoritative with the expectation that it would be followed without question. Then what do you mean by boycott? An individual who is tolerant of another person's religious beliefs or culture. This eventually led Akbar to the idea of sulaikul or universal peace. In actual practice, sulaikul represented a composition of not only religions but also music, art, literature, and other cultural achievements of people belonging to different religions. It was for practice and achievement of the principles of sulaikul that Akbar advocated Din-i-Ilahi. This has also been interpreted by scholars differently. Some regard it as the new religion, while others only see it as the principles of tolerance of sulaikul. Abul Fazl, Akbar's biographer, sees sulaikul as the framing of the vision of governance. This principle of governance is also emphasized by Jahangir and Shah Jahan, Akbar's successors. This principle of sulaikul has been explained by scholars differently. Some regard it as Akbar's religious policy, while others see it as a feature of imperial administration of peace and harmony. Akbar had ordered that all religions should be treated and tolerated equally in the administration of the state. The basic feature of sulaikul or universal tolerance has been described by Akbar's son Jahangir in the following words. Sunnis and Shiites met in one mosque, and Christians and Jews in one church to pray. He consistently followed the principle of universal peace, that is sulaikul. Next, move on to the Mughal Empire in the 17th century and after. The Mughal dynasty has been one of the most powerful dynasties of the world. The rulers of the Mughal dynasty left legacies that continued to inspire people of the modern world. The Mughal administrative and military efficiency led to economic and commercial prosperity in their regions. Some international travelers regarded the Mughal Empire as the fabled land of wealth. However, they were also horrified by the state of poverty there. During Shah Jahan's rule, documents revealed that there were a total of 445 high-ranking mansabdars out of 8,000. These mansabdars received 61.5% of the total estimated revenue of the empire as their salaries. A huge part of their income was spent on salaries and goods by Mughal emperor. By this expenditure, artisans and peasants were benefited as they provided goods to emperor. However, they were left with a very small amount of investment after the revenue collections. The poorest people earned just enough money to feed themselves. They could not invest in tools and supplies to increase their production of goods. On the other hand, the wealthier group of peasantry and artisans earned huge profits. In the late 17th century, these wealthier groups became powerful after earning huge wealth. As the authority of Mughal Empire weakened, their servants became the center of power in the regions. They formed new dynasties like Hyderabad and Awadh. For a few years, they recognized Mughal Emperor in Delhi as their master. By the 18th century, the provinces of the empire combine their independent political identities. Let us move on to elsewhere. Kings and queens. There were several great monarchs, all near contemporaries, in different parts of the world in the 16th century. They had expanded greatly in Central and West Asia. During this period, the Ottoman Empire had conquered the whole of Middle East, North Africa, and had also penetrated into Europe and formed Soviet Union. The Ottomans ruled over diverse people like Greeks, Arabs, slaves, and Armenians. The Ottoman ruler Sultan Suleiman in 1520 to 1526 reconstructed the Ottoman navy and dominated Mediterranean trade routes. He came to direct competition in conflict with the Spanish traders. In the Arabian Sea, the Portuguese were strong. They had also captured Goa in India. The Sultans of Delhi had strong relationship with the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman monarch was given the title of Al-Kunen, the lawgiver. Because of large number of rules, Kunan, he had passed in the region. These rules concern administrative procedures throughout Islamic domains including India, protection of peasantries from forced labor, protection of peasants from harsh measures and taxes, the authority of the ulamas. The power and authority of the Suleiman was also used by Delhi sultans for effective governance of India. With the decline of power of Ottoman sultans, the Delhi Sultanate also began to decline. The region of Suleiman Kunin was, however, was remembered for years to come. His reign was practically remembered for ideal governance. To the east of the Ottoman Empire lay Persia. The 16th century was the period of glory of Persia. The Persians had also regained some territories lost of Ottoman Empire earlier. It was under Akbar in the 16th century that Mughal civilization saw its glorious extent with progress in music, paintings, literature, and in other fields. I completed the chapter. Now I am going to read from the textbook. Page number 53. Akbarnama and Ainai Akbari. Akbar ordered one of his close friends and courtiers, Abul Fazil, to write a history of his reign. Abul Fazil wrote a 3-volume history of Akbar reign, titled Akbarnama. The first volume dealt with Akbar's ancestors, and the second volume recorded the events of Akbar's reign. The third volume is the Ainai Akbari. It deals with Akbar's administrations, household, army, the revenues, and the geography of his empire. It also provides rich details about the traditions and culture of the people living in India. The most interesting aspects about the Ainai Akbari is its rich statistical details about things as diverse as crops, yields, prices, wages, and revenues. A closer look at Akbar's policies. The broad features of administration were laid down by Akbar and were elaborately discussed by Abul Fazil in his book. The Akbarnama, in particular, in its last volume, the Ainai Akbari. Abul Fazil explained that the empire was divided into provinces called Subas, governed by the Subedar, who carried out both political and military functions. Each province also had a financial officer or Diwan. For the maintenance of peace and order in his province, the Subedar was supported by other officers such as the military paymaster Bakshi, the minister in charge of religious and charitable patronage Sat, military commanders Faujdas, and the town police commander's Kotwal. Akbar's nobles commanded large armies and had access to large amounts of revenue. While they were loyal, the empire functioned effectively by the end of the 17th century. Many nobles had built independent networks of their own. Their loyalties to the empire were weakened by their own self-interest. While Akbar was at Fatehpur Sikri during the 1570s, he started discussions on religion with the ulama, brahmanas, Jesuit priests who were Roman Catholics and Zoroastrians. These discussions took place in the Ibad Khan. He was interested in the religion and social customs of different people. Akbar's inspirations with people of different faiths made him realize that religious scholars who emphasized ritual and dogma were often boycotts. Their teachings created divisions and disharmony amongst his subjects. This eventually led Akbar to the idea of Sulaikul or universal peace. This idea of tolerance did not discriminate between people of different religions in his realm. Instead, it focused on a system of ethics, honesty, justice, peace that was universally applicable. Abul Fazl helped Akbar in framing a vision of governance around this idea of Sulaikul. This principle of governance was followed by Jahangir and Shahjahan as well. Sulaikul. Jahangir, Akbar's son, described his father's policy of Sulaikul in the following words: "As in the wide expanse of the divine compassions, there is room for all classes and the followers of all creeds, so in his imperial dominions, which on all sides were limited only by the sea, there was room for the professors of opposite religions and for beliefs, good and bad, and the road to intolerance was closed. Sunnis and Shias met in one mosque and Christians and Jews in one church to pray. He consistently followed the principle of universal peace, Sulaikul." The Mughal Empire in the 17th century and after. The administrative and military efficiency of the Mughal Empire led to great economic and commercial prosperity. International travelers described it as the fabled land of wealth. But these same visitors were also appalled at the state of poverty that existed side by side with the greatest opulence. The inequalities were glaring. Documents from the 12th year of Shahjahan's reign informed us that the highest ranking Mansabdars were only 455 in number out of the total of 8,000. This small number, a mere 5.6% of the total number of Mansabdars, received 61.5% of the total estimated revenue of the empire as salaries for themselves and their troopers. The Mughal emperors and their Mansabdars spent a great deal of their income on salaries and goods. This expenditure benefited the artisans and peasantries who supplied them with goods and produce. But the scale of revenue collection left very little for investment in the hands of the primary producers, the peasants and the artisan. The poorest amongst them lived from hand to mouth and they could hardly consider investing in additional resources, tools and supplies to increase productivity. The wealthier peasantries and artisanal groups, the merchants and bankers, profited in this economic world. The enormous wealth and resources commanded by the Mughal elite made them an extremely powerful group of people in the late 17th century. As the authority of the Mughal emperor slowly declined, his servants emerged as powerful centers of the power in the regions. They constituted new dynasties and held command of provinces like Hyderabad and Awadh. Although they continued to recognize the Mughal emperor in Delhi as their master. By the 18th century, the provinces of the empire had consolidated their independent political identities. Now, I completed the chapter. Hope you all understood. Thank you, children.